Hey everyone, thank you for clicking on this video. I just want to give a bit of a heads up that the audio is a little rough in this video because we were somewhere that's loud. And so I tried my hardest to play around with it and make it a little bit better, but it's not fantastic. So feel free to click on the captions. I uploaded them so that way you can just read it as well as watch it in case you need that. Hope you enjoy the video. Hey guys, so right now I'm with Camille Schreier. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure, I'm Camille. I have Ehlers-Danlos Syndrome, but I'm also Miss America 2020, and I'm a scientist, and I'm a pharmacy student, so love all things EDS.
She's basically very similar to me, as we both have a scientific background. I'm about to start my master's in human genetics, genetic counseling at Mount Sinai, and being Miss America, it seems like you've probably had to do a lot of different things while dealing with constant fatigue and chronic pain.
Yeah,
so I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that and how it has been, you know, in a community where people are usually not chronically ill.
It's really difficult comparatively to my peers who are able to kind of get through the day in a little bit of a different capacity than I am. I really struggle with my energy level, with really my ability to stand for long periods of time, and my cognition. And so in a pharmacy program, I need really all of those skills all of the time. And for me, I've had to figure out ways to allow myself to get through a really rigorous, hard day, both physically and mentally. So in all honesty, I take a lot of naps. I take a lot of rest time, whether or not it's even just laying horizontal for a certain period of time, which I feel like just helps my entire body re-regulate, like my entire blood flow and blood pressure. Just generally taking care of myself and not feeling weird having to do things differently than people around me. Because like, I can't always go and do the same things that my friends can, and that's okay. But just knowing my own limitations and advocating for myself in a lot of different situations has been really helpful.
When was the first time you met somebody who was also dealing with the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome?
I want to say that probably when I was in my teenage years. It was when I started to really talk about it, and a lot of other people my age were starting to get diagnosed with it. So I met a lot of people who were competing in pageants who had this, because when I would get on stage, I would talk about having Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and then people would come up to me and say, hey, I have that too. And I was like, that's so crazy because it's so rare. But in all honesty, it's not quite as rare as I think we all have always thought that it was.
Yeah.
And so I started to meet people, and now I have like a family of EDS people that I have gotten to know and really have shared experiences to what I do. That really brings us together in a different way.
Yeah, for sure. I think also just mentioning about how it's not nearly as uncommon as it used to be thought. Chip was just talking at a meeting or at dinner.
Yeah.
They were saying it used to be 1 in 5,000, and right now they're calling it 1 in 500, and I would not be shocked if it's more common than that.
So you were diagnosed pretty early, and so I would just like to hear a little bit about how you think that's affecting your treatment and how you're doing.
I'm really lucky to have been diagnosed early and very easily, and that is just a testament to a really good doctor that identified my total symptoms very early on. So I was diagnosed at 11, and I was then kind of put into preventative care mode from really pre-puberty, and that was really important for my long-term physical health. And I think it's been important for my mental health as well, because instead of having that experience where you constantly feel like you're making things up or people don't believe you, I just always kind of knew that there was something different about me, and I was able to cope with that in a different way. Now, my mom was diagnosed with me, so she was in her 40s, and that was important for her to be able to know in her 40s that she had been struggling with for so long, an issue that had a name. So we had very different experiences, and to talk about like the surgeries that people with EDS go through, my mom has had dozens of surgeries versus I haven't had any yet, knock on wood, with the exception of a few oral surgeries. And so I feel really lucky, and so the early detection is so important, and so that's why a lot of what I do is awareness-based, so that more people can understand what they're dealing with and have the tools to be able to make their life better.
Yeah, and I love that you mentioned it's more than just the physical, but also that validation that comes with diagnosis.
Oh, yes.
It is so hard to be dealing with chronic pain and all these symptoms and just not know what's causing them. So I think that's super important.
I have struggled with mental health in a lot of other ways in my life, but if I had to question all of the things that are happening with my body, in addition to all of the other stressors in my life, I can't imagine having to go through that. And so being able to have a name from the start has just given me such relief.
but has also been really cool for me to now kind of work with people with EDS and then also be able to see how EDS has progressed since 2007 when I was diagnosed until now in 2021, where it's in a completely different realm of understanding. And it's really cool for me to see the progression happen in my own treatment and science community.
So tonight we actually attended a dinner for the Norris Lab, which is a lab that has one of the best candidate hEDS genes.
Yes, it's been one that I got to visit today and really been able to see what's happening behind the scenes in the lab. The students, so the PhD students and the interns that are doing that research. But the really interesting thing about science is that you need the funding to be able to support that. And as someone who's affected with EDS, I am always looking for ways to not only spread awareness, but to directly support people that are doing the work to make the EDS community have a little bit an easier time. And so the Norris Lab is someone that's absolutely doing that right now. And so if those of you who are really passionate about EDS are called to donate, it's something that would really support the Norris Lab. You can find information on how to donate to the Norris Lab. I have it on my personal website, which is camillespire.com/advocacy. You can find the link to the Norris Lab, but there is another link which you might be able to post.
Yeah, put down in the description. This will be a fundraising video.
And so that is something that you can absolutely donate to. No donation is really too small. That pays for lab supplies. It pays for people to be able to be in the lab to do the work that we need.
There's
so much progress, so it's so exciting to be able to support that in a very direct way, and so I'm very passionate about it.
Yeah, so thanks so much, Camille.
Of course, thank you.